In the quest for clean energy, offshore wind stands out, not just for its towering turbines, which are already as tall as the Eiffel Tower and set to grow even further, but offshore wind also stands out for its surprising economics. Despite being about twice as expensive as its onshore counterpart, offshore wind is riding a wave of rapid global expansion. What drives this surge in investment towards seemingly pricier energy? In this video, we'll navigate the depths of offshore wind. We'll uncover the innovations making these titanic turbines possible, explore why their energy is more prized, and dive into the tumultuous waters of 2023 that nearly capsized the industry. Can offshore wind chart a course towards a more sustainable horizon? Let's set sail to find out. I'm Rosie Barnes, an engineer with a PhD in wind turbine design and 20 years experience developing clean energy technologies, including now working for my company, Part Alert Consulting. Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. When we look at an offshore wind turbine, it looks pretty much like an onshore wind turbine, only bigger and in the ocean. But in this case, looks are deceiving, and creating an offshore wind farm is not as simple as simply sticking a bunch of onshore turbines in the seafloor. It's not even close. Adapting wind turbines for the offshore environment is a complex engineering challenge. Waves, storms, and the corrosive marine atmosphere demand robust solutions to ensure the turbine's longevity and reliability. It's just such a harsh environment, not to mention the need for underwater cables and offshore transformer stations. Let's take a look at some of the engineering involved in adapting an onshore turbine design for offshore use. The most obvious difference between onshore and offshore is probably the support structure. Attaching a turbine to the seafloor is obviously a totally different kettle of fish compared to the methods we can use on land. And while the above water tower may be similar, the underwater substructure faces a very different environment. The dynamic forces exerted by the oceans make this a challenging problem, and different types of structures are employed depending on the sea depth, seabed conditions, and environmental considerations. Monopiles are the most common support structures. These are large steel tubes driven deep into the seabed. They must resist extreme forces while limiting rotation at the top, ensuring the turbine stability. Monopiles are quick and easy to install, but in deep waters, it's hard to make the single tube stable enough to resist overturning. So they're mostly used up to about 50 meter depths. Beyond that, jacket structures are more common as they offer a lighter solution for deeper waters. This type of support structure comes from the oil and gas industry, where they've been used in waters of hundreds of meters deep. Their design features a lattice of tubular steel legs and braces, and it provides high resistance to overturning moments through a wired base. So they use less material than a simple monopile, but with a more complex manufacturing method. So far, jacket structures have been used for wind turbines up to about 60 meter depth, and there's no real reason why they couldn't go deeper, but the amount of steel in that case would get really crazy. The other main type is gravity bases, which are similar in concept to the slab foundations used for onshore turbines. They rely on the weight of the structure itself to keep the turbine in place, but it's not quite as easy as in onshore foundations because buoyancy forces reduce their effective weight, so they often need to use additional ballast to compensate. Where the conditions are suitable for gravity foundations, they can be an economic choice, and they have the additional benefit of often causing less environmental damage than drilling pilings. However, transport and installation are challenging just simply due to their sheer weight and bulk. Other innovative support structures like tripods, tripiles, and floating platforms are also being explored to accommodate various offshore conditions. Floating offshore wind is especially interesting since it can be used in far deeper waters than fixed bottom. In fact, floating offshore wind is so interesting to me that I'm going to save that topic for a whole video on its own, so watch out for that one. The next really obvious difference between onshore and offshore wind is the size. Offshore turbines are significantly larger than onshore. Most new onshore models are in the 4 to 6 megawatt range, while offshore typically range from 12 to 16 megawatts. There are a few reasons why bigger makes more sense for offshore than onshore. Easier transportation of huge components is one. There's no need for components to fit on trucks and go under bridges, as they can be shipped directly from factories at ports. And the offshore support structures and undersea cable installation costs are cheaper for fewer large turbines than many smaller ones. The largest offshore turbines have now reached the height of the Eiffel Tower, and there's a trend towards even larger units, mainly from Chinese manufacturers. Mingyang's recent unveiling of a 20 megawatt turbine from their Shanwei factory highlights this trend. The announcement had a photo of staff in front of what looks like a large nacelle, which is the box at the top of the tower that houses the drivetrain. Photos of the blades, which would have to be 140-ish meters long, or any of the other gigantic components, were conspicuously absent, however, so it is possible that so far they've only made a really big box. China seems to be gearing up for yet bigger turbines to come, though, with a new blade test facility for 30 megawatt turbines recently announced. However, I've got to note that bigger doesn't always mean better or more cost-effective energy, as I detailed in this video on the scaling of wind turbines and whether they've already gotten bigger than they should have. The next big design challenge for offshore wind turbines is to protect against corrosion. The marine atmosphere is moist and laden with salt particles, which make conditions perfect for rust to form and destroy turbine components. To get around this, turbines are equipped with high-spec surface coatings, and designers go to great lengths to stop moist, salty air getting close to sensitive components. They use sealed generators with air-to-air heat exchangers and maintain the air in the nacelle above the dew point to prevent condensation. The nacelles and hubs may be pressurized to further safeguard internal components from coming into contact with outside air. One offshore design consideration that you can't see is the added importance of reliability. Offshore wind maintenance is far more challenging, costing about 3 times that of onshore due to difficult weather conditions and accessibility. High winds and rough seas delay repairs, and transport needs to be by boat or helicopter, which takes longer and costs more than the simpler logistics of onshore maintenance. So offshore turbines are designed with redundancy in critical systems, such as dual pitch angle measurement systems and spare frequency converter modules. And they may use more robust components than what is strictly necessary, like double row pitch bearings. All of these extras compared to onshore wind mean that offshore wind costs more, a lot more than onshore wind. In the US, the total capital cost for onshore wind ranges from about $1,500 to $2,500 per kilowatt, and that's for the whole project. And offshore wind projects are a little over double that, making it one of the most expensive renewable energy technologies. But this initial outlay is offset by several compelling advantages. Offshore wind turbines are exposed to higher wind speeds than onshore because in the ocean, there's no trees, hills, or buildings to slow down winds like there is over the ground. The airflow over water surfaces also results in lower wind turbulence at sea compared to land, which improves turbine efficiency and potentially extends operational life. The wind offshore also tends to be more consistent than onshore, which translates into higher capacity factors. That is, they produce closer to their maximum more of the time compared to onshore turbines. All of these add up to significantly increase energy output over their lifetimes. And another advantage, perhaps counterintuitively, offshore wind farms can actually often be located closer to coastal cities than onshore wind can. That reduces the need for expensive transmission infrastructure that's difficult to build and minimizing transmission losses. All of these advantages help to either increase the amount of energy offshore wind generates or to decrease the total cost of the wind farm. So on the one hand, we have more expensive turbines offshore, but on the other hand, more energy is generated and some project costs are reduced compared to onshore. To make a like-for-like comparison to find out whether the net effect is for cheaper or more expensive energy, we can use the levelized cost of energy, LCOE, as a comprehensive measure of the average cost per unit of electricity generated over a plant's whole lifetime. I made 2 whole videos on exactly how it's calculated and comparing all kinds of generation technologies earlier, so check those out if you want to know more. When you add up all the costs and divide by all the energy generated over its lifetime, a megawatt hour of offshore wind costs about twice as much as a megawatt hour from onshore wind on average, according to Lazard's latest LCOE report. You'll notice there is some overlap, so a great offshore wind project will yield cheaper energy than a bad onshore one, even in the US, which is where Lazard's data comes from. And in a country like Denmark, which has really favorable offshore wind resources and a long history of projects where they've learned how to reduce costs, that overlap is much larger. That is, there are many examples in Denmark of offshore wind farms delivering cheaper power than onshore. Let's take a closer look at Denmark now, as it serves as a really prime example of a country suited to offshore wind. Surrounded by the North Sea and the Baltic Sea, it's in a fantastic position to harness strong and steady winds. And they've been doing so since 1991, when they installed the world's first offshore wind farm at Vindebu, a town whose name aptly translates to Windy City. There's also an element of necessity behind the Danes' embrace of offshore wind energy. Denmark's been going hard on onshore wind for many decades, and now, frankly, they're running out of good spots to put them. With limited land available and a very populated countryside, Denmark has turned to its expansive maritime territory to expand its wind capacity. Most new Danish wind installations in recent years have been offshore, which now makes up about a third of their 7 gigawatt total wind capacity and nearly half of the actual energy coming from wind in Denmark. Together, that's over 50% of Denmark's electricity coming from wind. And looking to the future, plans to add at least another 6 gigawatts of offshore wind by 2030 should more than double the amount of wind energy generated in the country, though much of that capacity will be exported abroad. Not everywhere is as blessed blessed as Denmark to have offshore projects that are cost competitive with onshore wind. But even where electricity from onshore wind comes at a premium to onshore, many regions around the world are still ambitiously expanding their offshore wind capabilities. More ambitiously than Denmark, in fact. For example, the UK is aiming to increase from 15 gigawatts of offshore wind today to 50 gigawatts by 2030, which will be about enough to power every UK home. And over in the US, New York's target to go from essentially zero today to 9 gigawatts of offshore wind power by 2035 is another example of a big investment in offshore wind. But why would they do that when it costs so much? There are a lot of compelling non-financial reasons driving the shift towards offshore installations. The first we already mentioned when we talked about Denmark. In densely populated or ecologically sensitive areas, space to install onshore wind farms may be limited. Offshore wind offers vast expanses of space with minimal land use conflicts, and offshore wind farms often have a lower environmental cost compared to onshore. Furthermore, some people don't like looking at wind farms, or they think they're too noisy to live near. Offshore wind farms, if they're located far from shore, can avoid those perceptions and lead to better social acceptance. And there are actually financial reasons that aren't captured in the LCOE as well. Namely, the value of offshore wind can be much higher than onshore and other renewables. One of the most significant advantages of offshore wind is the often uncorrelated nature of its generation profile with onshore wind and solar power. By that I mean, when the sun is not shining and onshore wind is not blowing, offshore wind is often cranking, and in places with a lot of renewables already, the times when those sources are unavailable are the times when electricity prices are high. In our 100% renewable future, those will be the times that expensive storage would be needed. This means that offshore wind can earn more money for the energy it generates and contribute to a more consistent energy supply and reduce reliance on energy storage solutions. Another source of value is that in many offshore areas, the windiest time of day aligns closely with peak demand periods, which is usually in the evenings. This alignment is crucial because this is when the energy prices tend to be higher. So once again, offshore wind farms can achieve higher revenues per megawatt hour compared to onshore wind or solar installations whose peak generation times don't tend to coincide with peak demand. A good example of this is New York's coastline, whose consistent and strong winds are particularly robust during the late afternoon and evening hours. This is in addition to the fact that they have significantly below average onshore wind resources available in New York and in New England. There, onshore wind's capacity factors are in the range of just 12 to 18%, which makes offshore wind's capacity factor in the high 40s look pretty damn appealing despite the higher cost of the turbines. And to give an Australian example, in Perth, Western Australia, offshore wind capacity also peaks in the late afternoon and evening. This phenomenon is so prevalent that it even has a local nickname, the Fremantle Doctor, called that because those winds consistently bring relief after oppressively hot summer days. The shape of this curve of potential offshore production in Perth is very close to the opposite of the solar power curve. It's pretty much a perfect match. And something similar can happen seasonally too. In New York, the offshore wind achieves maximum capacity factors in the winter, which is perfect to contribute during times of high heating demand. And back to Perth, the Fremantle Doctor is strongest in the summer, which is when peak energy demand occurs there, as aircon is turned on to deal with the maximum daily temperatures routinely over 40 degrees at that time of year. That is pretty much everything that I wanted to say about the how and why of offshore wind. But now we need to put it in context, because things have not been going swimmingly for offshore wind recently, especially in New York and in the UK. I would go so far as to say that 2023 was a bit of a crisis year for the industry. In the last few years, the cost of offshore wind abandoned its long-term downward trajectory and rose. A lot. We all know inflation has been high recently, interest rates have gone up, and new energy projects of all kinds got more expensive for a while. But for offshore wind, prices rose more than other projects. And because the capital cost is so much higher than in other types of energy, it mattered a lot more. And prices in other sectors like solar panels and batteries have started to drop again, whereas offshore wind prices remain elevated. The consequence of all these things is that in 2023, about half of the offshore wind projects underway in New York were either in dispute or cancelled after the state denied developers' requests to increase the amount of money they'd be paid for energy from those committed projects. In response to this setback, New York State announced a new offshore wind solicitation for those same sites. Two big projects by Ørsted and Equinor that were cancelled late last year have just been re-awarded at a higher price. So things are maybe back on track there. The situation in the UK mirrored New York's challenges when their 2023 auction for offshore wind projects received precisely zero bids. Developers were dissuaded by the ceiling price offered by the UK government, which was £44, that's $54, of guaranteed revenue per megawatt hour of power produced, which they deemed too low to cover the now higher costs of project development. The UK has responded by increasing the price for the next round by 75% to £77. These events highlight the volatility and financial risks inherent in emerging areas like offshore wind, which have high capital costs. I think lessons have been learned, and we will be able to look back on 2023 as a blip in the overall picture of offshore wind, but it's given us all a reality check about what it will take to actually deliver all those gigawatts of capacity we're planning in the next decade. I think with renewable energy, we've maybe gotten a little bit too used to constantly decreasing prices, ensuring project profitability without having to think about much else or do proper risk analyses. And I hope that's going to change in the future, with countries getting proactive about ensuring that the right pieces are in place for offshore wind projects to actually get delivered. It's really important to get these settings right to ensure a consistent pipeline of projects if we're to have any chance of achieving the ambitious targets that countries involved have outlined. When the entire industry stops and starts, like it has been recently, it has a really harmful effect on everyone involved. If it's going to move fast, a new industry like offshore wind needs certainty to get the supply chain secured, to get ports upgraded, ships built, and a workforce trained. So I hope we can all learn from the turmoil of 2023 and do better next time these kinds of challenges come up. Thanks to the Engineering with Rosie Patreon team, whose support makes these videos possible. If you want to join us, then please feel free to do so at this link. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.